All right, well, welcome. Hey, if you're new here today, I want to introduce you to one of these pink cards. And if you'd be willing to fill that out and stick it in the offering basket when it comes by, we will come beat on your door and bother you on the phone. No, we won't do either of those things. We promise, in fact, to not do those things. But through the mail, send you some information about New Hope. So if you're interested in that, we'd love to send you that information through the mail. A few announcements this morning. Before we get started, I'll let you know where Tim is in Tahoe with his bride. They're celebrating their anniversary, so that's really sweet out there, and I hope they have a great time. Yeah, yeah. Unfortunately for Tim, though, he had to come back for a funeral, and then he broke down on his way back to Tahoe, and anyway, he got a car to drive, and he's back with his bride today, so hopefully they can salvage a little bit of what they had going on there. But anyway, other things going on at New Hope Community Church, not a ton this week. It is the tail end of a holiday week. You guys ready to go back to work and school? No? No? All right. That's okay. It's the new year, though, so you still have a holiday to celebrate. And speaking of new year, the youth are having an event here from 6:30 to 12:30. So if you're in junior high to high school, you're welcome to come to that. We're going to watch a live stream event that includes some bands from all over and a ball dropping. We'll have some fun together playing some games. Other things going on this week, it looks like just celebrate recovery and youth stuff. So the rest of you guys are heathens, and that's a joke. I hope you know that. Gosh, you guys are a little slow this morning. Or I stutter, it could be too. DVDs on sale for $10. Those are the recordings of our Christmas service here. And if you want to pick those up, you can get them, I assume, in the office. Nope, you have to go to our website and order them at newhopechurch.net. So have fun on that website. I think that's it. Oh, our offering today. This is kind of cool. New Hope has discovered they're in a wonderfully blessed position financially this year. And so about a month ago, we started talking about what we could do with the surplus God has given us. And through that conversation came some talk about giving today's offering to missions work. So all of what is being collected today is going to be going to missions outside of the church, which I think is kind of cool. So they'll go to local outreach and foreign outreach, and none of it stays in-house. So also, I think this is the last Sunday, is it not, where you can put a tax-deductible contribution into the offering. So yeah, I guess that's it. So I'll invite our ushers to come forward. Is that it? Did I do okay, Milo? I feel like I'm messing up the whole church. It's going to fall down any minute. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Oh, you know what? Also, be praying for Louise Ward and the family. Her sister, Barbara Hutchinson, her service was yesterday. So be praying for the family. So this time we'll receive our offerings, and if you'll take a moment to pray with me, let's go to God. Father God, we come to you this morning from all different backgrounds and positions in our life, God. Some of us are broken, and we know it. Some of us, God, are coming down from a holiday high. And some of us don't even know why we're here. But you do, God. And I don't think it's any mistake that anyone in this room is here. So we thank you for this morning. We thank you for a church that has warm, welcoming, loving people in it because of the love, God, that you first showed us. We thank you for the many blessings, God, that you've given us, and ask that you accept these offerings as just a token, a small portion of what you've already shown us through the love of your Son, our Lord. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen. Hey, sorry you have to see me again. But you'll get over that in just a second. I want to introduce somebody to you today. In Tim's absence, we needed to fill the pulpit with somebody, and we couldn't find anyone. And so, actually, no, we're in for a real treat today. Our guest speaker today is no stranger to New Hope. She started attending New Hope when she was in high school in the 90s, if you can remember that far back.
You're older than me.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, a little bit. Yeah. Just a little bit. And serious about her search for God. Once she discovered Christ, her thirst and hunger for him has been unquenchable. After high school, she attended Ravencrest Chalet for a year, and that's a Bible school. And I'm told you can learn more in a year at Ravencrest than you can in 4 years of college around here. So That's a pretty big deal to live your whole life out there, eat, drink, breathe, and sleep the things of God. She's married to James Gallardo. She has two beautiful daughters. She's worked in our junior high department as a director. She is currently employed by Fresno Unified as a guidance learning advisor at a junior high. She has had she has a multiple subject teaching credential and an administrative credential and a master's degree in school counseling. Wow. You have a
I have a lot of school.
A lot of
student loans. Yeah.
Yeah. So maybe some of the missions outreach should be
my student loan
pastoral
fund.
Pastoral student debt or something to that effect. She currently serves as one half of our two-part small group director, the other half being Teddy Miller, of course, and they're doing a great job. It's proved to be already the largest ministry at New Hope, and that's pretty cool in only a year's time. So here to challenge us today is Corey Gallardo.
Oh, that was good. Thank you. So I'm freaking out. Thank you for that introduction. It's a privilege, terrifying, to be sharing with you today. I'm much more comfortable following script or having Dylan Little standing next to me. So I'd even be more comfortable if you were wearing like VBS shirts and hopped up on popsicles, Skittles or something and could run back and forth. That'd be a little bit better for me. Tim first asked me to speak today and I told him no. And then he asked me to talk about small groups and so then I couldn't tell him no because everything that I've read and heard about helping a small group stay alive and grow is to talk about it, talk about it, talk about it. So I couldn't say no. I'm not going to just talk about small groups. So if you're already in a small group or you have no interest in one, don't tune me out. We're going to talk about other things besides small groups. I'm actually want to focus on these three questions, which is one, do you have hope? Two, where does your hope come from? And three, are you sharing this hope? I think that these three questions are fitting in regard to our hope groups because they're called hope groups. And the hope stands for helping other people engage, which leads to the other part of what we're going to talk about, which is our connecting to each other. The focus of small groups is to connect, grow, reach, and serve. So before I start, do you like how I did that before I start? See, Tim says that we have a lot in common, and it's probably the worst parts of us that we have in common. So I'm actually not counting the time that I've already spoken as part of my time, so feel free to settle in. Those of you who know me know I've now been handed a microphone, and I like a microphone, so get comfortable. We might be here a while. Those of you who don't know me, I am Corey Gallardo. Not always been Corey Gallardo, but I'm now Corey Gallardo. I arrived here midweek about 20 years ago. There was nobody here. I had been investigating the Mormon church, and I was preparing to set a baptism date for my birthday, and my mom was a little had some concerns and didn't know what to do. And so her boss at the time remembered that he'd gone to high school with a guy who was the pastor of a church. And so they looked up that church, and she called here. And the youth pastor at the time had just completed a lesson series, that included some lessons on the Mormon church. So I obviously believe in the divine work of the Holy Spirit because he brought me here. At the right time with the right information. But I arrived here not full of hope. I was angry and I was confused. And it was a bit of a journey to have the hope that I have now, which leads me to this verse because This verse is Romans 15, 14, and 15, and so many of you have been part of my journey over the last 20 years here, and so I want to share this verse with you. I myself am convinced, my brothers, that you yourselves are full of goodness, complete in knowledge, and competent to instruct one another. I've written you quite boldly on some points, as if to remind you of them again, because of the grace God gave me. So I am by no means coming here today resolving any sort of biblical mysteries or any profound thought, just here to remind you of things we've talked about in relation to connecting, growing, reaching, and serving, and our hope. The focus of my message today, or the objective in teacher language, my objective is Romans 15, 13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. I read a book over the summer called Connecting in Communities by Eddie Mosley, and it left an impression on me, and it's challenged me. And to be very honest with you, I haven't done much with this challenge. It's just been sort of resting on my heart. The book is about neighborhood small groups. It's kind of different than what we're doing here. The way we've started small groups here is we're part of this church, and we say, hey, I want to connect better with people, grow, study the Bible, and maybe in a smaller setting. You guys have, the small groups have done service projects and reached out to each other, and that's the heart of small groups, and it's amazing. It's really neat to be part of that. This book, the author asks and answers this question, though, a little bit different. How do you go from a church with a successful Sunday school program that reaches those who choose to come to God to a growing small group ministry that impacts people in your community, your subdivision, your schools, and your city? The book tells stories of how people reached out to their neighbors, their coworkers, to connect with each other, to grow in their relationship with Christ, and then to serve others. As one of the churches that they were talking about at one point realized that their small group, the number of small group members, was larger than their Sunday morning attendance. And it wasn't that the small groups had replaced Sunday morning, but it was that the small groups had been reaching out to people, and that people were first coming to know Christ through the small groups and then coming to the larger congregation, which is a little bit different than how we have been doing things. We invite people to come to church here and then connect them to something. So this was connecting to the smaller setting first and then bringing to the larger. Very similar to Billy Graham's My Hope for America, in the start inviting people into your homes. They know you, they trust you, they love you, they know your hope, and they want to share that with you, and then inviting them to the larger congregation. That My Hope piece comes from 1 Peter 3, 13 through 16. Who's going to harm you if you're eager to do good? But even if you should suffer for what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear what they fear. Do not be frightened. But in your hearts, set apart Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give a reason for the hope you have. But do this with gentleness and respect. So that takes me back to those first three questions. Do you have hope? Where does your hope come from? And are you sharing this hope with others? We want to connect with people. We're designed to connect with people. Many of you have heard of Maslow's hierarchy of needs, right? That triangle. The base of our needs, our first needs that have to be met, are those physical. We have to have food and shelter. And then after that is safety, that freedom from fear, know that things are calm and safe. And then the middle one is socialization, that desire to belong, that sense of belonging, to connect with people. Then it's self-esteem and self-actualization. Most of us find ourselves, kind of the people we know, stuck in this social searching for belonging, and oftentimes in the wrong places. We're spinning around just reaching and trying to connect. We're Looking for love in all the wrong places. Looking for love in too many faces. I have a microphone. Looking for love. Looking for love. There's lots of songs, right, about this need for connectedness, this socialization. We even see this with Adam, right? Right in the very beginning, we have Adam. Adam has all his physical needs met. He has food, he has shelter. He was lacking in the clothing department, but apparently that wasn't all that important. I don't know. I like the clothing and my physical needs. And then he was safe. He was walking with God, talking with God, and then there was that socialization. So he starts like hanging out with the animals and naming them and stuff, and that just wasn't enough. And so God gave him Eve. And we see that God is not expecting us to go through this journey alone. We have him, and he's given us each other. And then there's also, I think about Jesus and the 12 disciples. They're like this small group doing life together, right? They're connecting, they're growing, they're reaching, and they're serving. And they're doing this together. In John 17:20, he's praying for the disciples. And then he says, "My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message." I think we're part of that, right? We're people who have come to believe in Christ because of the message. "That all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me. May they be brought to complete unity to let the world know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me." And again, we see that theme of unity. And yet for some of us, church is limited to our rows, and we come here and we're next to people, but we're not necessarily with each other. Most of you are familiar with Romans 12:4. If you want to open your Bibles there, you've probably heard these verses before about how we fit into this body. We are the body of Christ. We're meant to be unified to each other. So Romans 12:4, "Just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same functions, so in Christ we who are many form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given us. If a man's gift is prophesying, let him use it in proportion to his faith. If it is serving, let him serve. If it is teaching, let him teach. If it is encouraging, let him encourage. If it is contributing to the needs of others, let him give generously. If it is leadership, let him govern diligently. If it is showing mercy, let him do it cheerfully. We all have these gifts to contribute to one another. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with God's people who are in need. Practice hospitality." As I was reading those verses, I saw how connected our relationship with God is to our connection with other people. It goes back and forth. Our spiritual fervor and zeal to serving others and practicing hospitality. And I kept thinking, oh my goodness, I'm too tired for all that zeal and spiritual fervor, which I think means maybe we need to slow things down. And busyness, I think, is something that gets in my way of sharing that spiritual fervor and keeping my zeal. Or fear, which leads me to thinking about how keeping that spiritual fervor and zeal is a little bit easier within the confines of the church family. It feels safer to practice hospitality, to be generous, this church is horrendously, wonderfully hospitable. You stop what you're doing and cook food and bring in here and you serve and you clean up, and the church is always open for something if anybody needs it. But for some reason, and maybe it's just me, I don't know that I have that same boldness when it comes to my neighborhood. I think that can be a little bit harder. I am not the friendly neighbor at my neighborhood. I don't even know if they really know who I am. They know who my husband is. He is the friendly neighbor. I don't know if it's because he wants to share his spiritual zeal or if it's because he's avoiding being inside the house, but when I come home, I drive into the driveway, I hop out of my car, beep, beep, and I run in, open the doors, lock it, and I am in. I don't answer the phone. I almost never even answer the door, so good luck coming to my house. He, however, will stand out there and talk to people. He knows everybody's name. He knows what's going on. If something's been broken into, he's got all the stories. I don't even remember. I'm like, who? That? I don't know. Okay. You know, that's his job. And I've realized, though, I've been challenged that can't just be his job. I have this neighborhood full of wonderful people. And I've been especially challenged because of something that happened at the end of this summer. I walk because on the other side of my street is my in-laws. There's a house and then my parents. And then across the street from them is my daughter's little best friend. So we all live in this little, our little community. And so I walk, and at the end of my little loop across the street is the Franks' home. And Mr. Franks is always, the garage door is always open, and he's got this rolling office chair that he sits in, and he either watches sports on a TV in there. He's obviously avoiding being inside, too. Or he wheels his chair out onto the sidewalk and, like, bakes with his dog Chocolate next to him. And so I throw the kids in the stroller, and I walk by the way of Mr. Franks' house, and I say hi, and he says hi, and the girls wave to Chocolate, and we talk about whether or not it's hot enough out, because both of us like it really hot, like skin boiling hot, which is a little weird, and so we feel a little fellowship with one another, and that we both like it weirdly hot. And then I go on to the other side of the street, visit with my in-laws, visit with my parents, visit with my daughter's friend. And as it starts to get dark, I load them back up, and I come back by the way of Mr. Frank's house, and he's still sitting there, and we say hi from across the street. How are you? And I keep walking back to my house and run in and lock the door. And at the end of this summer, Mr. Franks and his wife were in a tragic car accident. Actually, it was a motorcycle accident. And Mr. Franks passed away, and his wife survived. And I kept feeling like I needed to do something. But I haven't, because I don't know what to do, because I realized that I don't know them and they don't know me. That I just wave and talk about the weather, that I don't know their hope and I don't know that they know my hope. And so all I know is that I have to do something different than what I'm doing right now, because what I'm doing right now is walking the other direction, to the other side of the street, so that I don't have to pass by their house because the garage door is closed. And I've been continually challenged to do something differently. And now that I've told you all of that, I'm going to have to. So that's my own personal challenge. So that leads me to Acts 9. What do we do? Acts 9, if you want to open your Bibles there. At the beginning of the chapter, Saul, later known as Paul, some of you may know this chapter is Saul's conversion chapter. And so at the beginning of the chapter, Saul is breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. And just a few verses later, he's on the road to Damascus, and he is spoken to by the Lord, or angel of the Lord, and he's blinded, and he converts. He becomes a believer. And for 3 days, he's blind and doesn't eat or drink anything. And then later, God sends Ananias to lay hands on him. And Saul's sight is restored. And he's filled with the Holy Spirit. This is all still in chapter 9. At verse 19, after taking some food, he regains his strength and spends several days with the disciples in Damascus. So he is on his way because he hates the Lord's people. He realizes, he accepts Jesus as true, believes that Jesus is the Lord, and then goes and spends some quiet time, some small group time with disciples. A few days, several days. Doesn't complete a 12-week study before he does something. He spends a couple of days in fellowship with believers. And then, verse 20, still in chapter 9, at once he began to preach in the synagogues that Jesus is the Son of God. Spent some time with the believers in connection, and then began to preach what he knew. And what he knew was Jesus was the Son of God. And all of those who heard him were astonished and asked, isn't he the man who raised havoc in Jerusalem among those who call on his name? And hasn't he come here to take them as prisoners to the chief priests? So people are a little confused. They're a little confused. But that doesn't hold Paul back. Yet, Saul grew more and more powerful and baffled the Jews living in Damascus by proving that Jesus is the Christ. Are you holding back from connecting because or reaching because your reputation? Or because you feel unworthy? Because you don't know if you have the answers? Are you hesitant to open your home to your neighbors or suggest one at work because you're afraid? If it makes you feel better, later in the same chapter, I realize that God didn't expect Saul to do this all by himself. Barnabas was with him, and in verse 26, it says, when he came to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples. Hey, guys! And they were freaking out. They were afraid of him, not believing that he really was a disciple. No, it's good. Like, I'm Paul now, right? We're all good. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles. And when I read that, I thought God could have done something differently. God could have said, they came to know that Saul was a disciple, or an angel could have appeared to them and said, don't be afraid, Saul's a disciple. But it was a fellow believer. It was Barnabas who came with him and partnered with him and said to the disciples, he told them how Saul on his journey had seen the Lord and that the Lord had spoken to him, and how in Damascus he had preached fearlessly in the name of Jesus. So Saul stayed with them and moved about freely in Jerusalem, speaking boldly in the name of the Lord. Fearlessly, boldly. Do you have hope? Where does your hope come from? Are you sharing that hope with others? The Bible talks about a childlike faith, being humble like a child, and I am always, that's why VBS is so much fun, is to just see how fearlessly and boldly kids love Jesus. My oldest started kindergarten this year, and I was terrified. I didn't even put her in preschool, because I was like, I'm not sending her out into this cold, cold, mean world. Somebody's going to call her a name and like pull her hair, and I was not ready. And one night, she says to me, it's okay if mommy and daddy don't go to kindergarten with me. And I looked at her and she said, because I have Jesus in my heart and Jesus is with me. She was not afraid because she was not alone. She knew she was not alone because she had Jesus with her. That's hope. That's her face, that is hope that we want to share with others. Do you have that kind of hope that you can trust in him, that you're not alone? And are you sharing that with other people? If your hope is not found in Christ, the things that are not of Christ will pass away. They will go away. There's that if-then kind of hope. If this happens, then I'll have hope. If I win the lottery, then I'll have lots of hope. If I find the dream man, then I'll have lots of hope. But the kind of hope that comes from Jesus is a different hope. It's a lasting hope, an eternal hope, a real hope that does not fail. And it's never too late to find that hope. Paul had not been preparing to receive Jesus. He was on his way to persecute believers, but Jesus was ready for him. Jesus is ready for you. He knows your name, and he knows your sin, and he knows your burdens. And if you allow him, he can forgive you of your sin, carry your burdens, and write your name in the book of life. All you have to do is ask. So where does your hope come from? If it's not from him, then it's like a roller coaster ride. And I encourage you to grow in your trust with God so you can have that lasting hope. And if you are full of hope, are you sharing this with others like Paul, who immediately went to the synagogues to share that Jesus is God? Are we willing to step out of our comfort zones to share our hope with a hurting people? I want to share a video. It's a Jars of Clay song that I came across this week. And at first, I really liked the beginning, and then the chorus came, and I was kind of confused by it. Because it says, we find shelter in each other. And I was like, oh, we find shelter in him. We find shelter in his wings. He says, come to me, I'll be your shelter. And I do believe that the writers, the Jars of Clay, believe that. But I also, it took me back to those verses about his body. Are we allowing God to live in and through us so that we can be that shelter to somebody else, so we can show people God's comfort and show people God's love? So when I watched an interview that they asked, why does it say we are the shelter? And the lead singer said, when we come to church and we sing worship songs, we usually sit and we face the screen, and it's just us and God, which is good. But they wanted to do something different that also made us think about the people standing next to us. And that made sense to me because, like I said, I came here not full of hope and angry and confused, and many of you have been his shelter for me in regaining my hope. And that we're not meant to do this alone. We're not meant to do life alone. He's given us each other. So let's look at each other. Let's allow God to use us to bring comfort and hope, his hope. Hebrews 10:23-25 says, let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. So I would like to share this video with you, and you may have your own opinion on it, but I hope it blesses you. So before I close in prayer, I do want to make a plug for small groups, because I believe that being part of a small group, or at least starting to make sure we get to know each other here better, can meet us wherever we are. If we have no hope, if we find ourselves finding hope in things that are not of Christ, because we're learning to trust in him, or if we're full of hope, that being part of a small group can help work through any of those questions. And then also the connect, grow, reach, and serve part of that. So on January 26th, tentatively, as of right now, we're talking about doing a social for the people who are already in small groups and to be able to share what's going on in those small groups, and a relaunch for anybody who's interested in joining small groups to help you connect with a group, join a group, hear more about small groups. And maybe you're thinking about doing something a little bit different. Maybe you're thinking about starting a study in your neighborhood or in your workplace or something like that, and we can certainly help you form those groups as well and find materials or whatever. So I encourage you to be praying about that and thinking about that. as we move forward. But more importantly, if you have no hope, or you've been hoping in things apart from Christ, or you're full of hope and don't know how to share it, prayer is the first place to start. So I ask you to join me in prayer. Lord Jesus, we humbly come before you and thank you for your grace. And if there's anyone here who's never accepted your grace and gift of eternal life, I pray that they would acknowledge that they have sinned and need your salvation, and allow you to be the Lord of their lives and the source of their hope. I pray for those who are struggling to let go and allow you to be their hope. I pray that we would surrender our worries and our fears and our plans over to you and walk in trust and experience the joy that comes from trusting in you. And I pray for boldness and courage to share our faith and hope with others so that they too could experience the joy that comes from a relationship with you and the hope of eternal life. We give all glory and praise to you. In Jesus' name, amen. So again, may the hope of God, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Thank you. Have a great week.